here they are. The Bee Gees.
Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready? The Bee Gees!
We're sort of an enigma, because no one can really explain us. We've been through so many ups and downs that it's impossible to explain what we are or where we fit in. And maybe that's okay. It is for us, because we don't enjoy being grouped with anybody. We like the idea of being unique. We like the idea that we can still surprise people. That's all great for us. We don't need to feel that we're on a pedestal. And if we feel that we're on a pedestal, we won't do good work.
And we've got to keep
the hunger going, you know? We fall off a lot.
Florida, part-time home to one of music's top five recording acts of all time, the Bee Gees. Now that stat may surprise some, but when you consider they've been recording since the mid-60s and have sold in excess of over 110 million albums worldwide, it's not that surprising. Add to that total sales figure the brand new album, This Is Where I Came In, and you have the story of the Bee Gees.
You know what's amazing, just walking around and looking at the stuff? And I'm impressed. You know, there's just so many pictures.
You mean the way they've been hung?
So what happens when you're walking around? Do you all of a sudden stop and you go,
Well, you jump, you see a certain picture, because we haven't seen a lot of these pictures. They've all been put up in the last year. And so, you sort of jump when you see a picture of yourself from 30 years ago that you actually don't remember having taken.
This is the danger zone. This is where I came in. They don't know what they do. Forgive them all their sins. They know they cannot take away what you have given me.
This is just where I came in. What is it about Miami? You first recorded here in 74, I think.
About right, what, yeah. Main Course? Yeah. Well, we came here to make an album because we were trying to make a comeback. And we'd been through our 60s and early 70s period, and we weren't really selling records at that point. And we had a conversation with Eric Clapton one day at NEMS, Robert Stigler.
Right.
And he'd been trying to make a comeback. Could you get that, Pedro?
Yes, yeah.
There's Eric Clapton there.
Yeah, Eric. Are you talking
Don't quote me,
again.
You boss. Who was playing guitar. And he says, well, I just made an album in America, in Miami, and it was a great experience and a different one than making records in Europe. Why don't you go to America, make a record, and be influenced by American taste and America and the culture, you know? And that's how Main Course came about. That's what it is. It's purely a vibe. I mean, 20 years ago, 15 years ago, there was nobody here.
No. I mean, this what we call South Beach now was totally, you know, very
elderly,
rough area.
Elderly people sitting in the sun. Yeah.
So it must feel like home then at this point to you.
Well, 23 years, but we did consider England home too.
Yeah, so. We've got houses in England as well.
Yeah. Yeah. And sort of as a bit of home in Australia as well.
A guitar for my 9th Christmas. Morris and Robin, they just seemed to follow suit. They wanted to do the same thing, so they had little toy guitars that they played, and I guess we just became a group at that point.
Where is the light that
that would play in my street. And where are the friends I could meet?
Existing must be dead. Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you know what it's like on the outside? Don't go talking too loud, you cause a landslide, Mr. Jones.
Harmonies are concerned. We're a three-piece harmony group, and in fact they were a three-piece harmony group, apart from Ringo, you know.
And the nasal tones.
Yeah, so but we were fans of theirs as well as everybody else, so, you know, it didn't really apply to us mentally. It just applied to other people who thought that way.
We wanted to be like the Beatles. It was as simple as that. We didn't think about money or anything like that. We just wanted what they had, the approval of the masses. Everybody loved what they did, and we loved to experiment and do things like that. So that we all knew then we wanted to be like the Beatles.
We have been accused of emulating or sounding like the Beatles in our younger days, and that's absolutely true. We love the Beatles, and we often used to go out of our way to copy their sound.
I started to cry, which started the whole world laughing. Oh, if I'd only seen that the joke was on me.
In those days, people didn't want to copy the Beatles. Everyone wanted to be the Beatles. So you had a lot of groups with mop-top hairstyles and to dress and act as much like the Beatles as humanly possible, to the point of embarrassment. So it was very difficult to not be the Beatles, you know, to try and be something else.
Like the Beatles, you also switch lead vocals, which continues to be a rare thing even these days.
We enjoy doing it.
Well, when we did songs like Fanny Be Tender and stuff, where it bounced from Robin to Barry on lead.
Do you think I'm gonna stand here blinded in the rain? And it's the start of a love affair. The moment when I despair.
That kind of marriage which not many groups have.
What's nice is you get this character at the beginning and then suddenly another character takes over, and it used to happen with a lot of R&B groups, you know, where you'd have different leads taking over from each other. So we don't see any problem with that. We enjoy doing that because that gives the listener a pleasant surprise, or an unpleasant surprise.
What the hell was that?
Yeah. love somebody, to love somebody the way I love you.
With the harmonies, do you ever surprise yourself? Just like, do you ever give yourself goosebumps?
I still get goosebumps every time we do, especially when we're performing. Because I remember doing it when we were kids and we did it the first time and we all looked at each other with an amazement at what we'd just done.
Where'd that come from?
And that feeling never goes away, especially when we're doing the acoustic medley on stage particularly. Mm-hmm. There's a certain feeling that you just hit a right balance that makes you go, oh, it just feels great. You know, so it's hard to explain, but it's something that I guess brothers have, but there's a buzz there that goes on.
Is it that natural or is it trial and error in the studio?
No, it's that natural. It's something we've done since we were children.
Yeah, it's just not something we started with kids. We just started singing in harmony and we didn't even question it.
No, it's just because you can't learn how to sing in harmony. It's sort of instinctive because you're literally singing another melody off the melody. Fifths and thirds and things like that were not things in our head. We just found another place. Morris would find another place to sing. Robin would find another place to sing.
Mine was the toilet.
If I was doing the melody or if Robin was doing the melody, I would find another place to sing. But harmonically, it would work. Where there are brothers involved, like the Beach Boys, and where there's a sonic resemblance between the voices that comes from birth.
You know, even like the Beatles, who all came from the same area.
Yeah.
They all had that nasal...
They weren't related, but...
No, but they had a nasal toning.
The same nasal way they speak, which is more like that, you know, sort of...
It's all bottom.
Sort of singing becomes like that, too.
Yeah, so when they sing together, they sound like a team, like brothers. Can you from shining, what makes the world go round? How can you mend this broken man? How can a loser ever win? Please help me mend my broken heart.
Any song that we heard that was in harmony, we would emulate, you know. And that's how the harmonies began. They were singing harmonies about 6 years old, easy. But you ain't got a dime. There's no time for the fool. I just gotta get a message to you. Hold on, hold on. One more hour and my life will be through.
It wasn't written as a duet originally.
It was written for Kenny as a solo artist. There were no duets at all. And even in the case of the Streisand album, there were no duets planned. They just sort of happened by accident. And in this case, it also happened by accident. Kenny was, we just wrote, that was one of the five songs that we wrote for Kenny, whether it was the early bunch or the late bunch of songs.
Yeah, it was the later one, yeah.
Yeah. he loved that. And then he asked us to come up with a suggestion. He wanted to do a duet with somebody. And he said, if I do a duet with one of these songs, can you guys come up with any thoughts as to who? Well, we knew that he'd work with Dolly, but we knew that he'd never done a duet with her. And he'd done a duet with a lot of other people, so we made that suggestion.
Making love with each other. Islands in the street.
That's what happened, and Dolly came in and she did the vocal. And what we had to do was obviously change key for her. So we had to change key in the middle of the song into another key for her to do that. And how we do that, how we find out, make that work, what we do is we do one verse in Kenny's key and then we do another verse with my falsetto, because my falsetto is in a woman's key, and if we do it about right, we figured out the woman's key pretty easily and it works. That's one of the reasons where we've been able to write for women successfully, because using the falsetto voice, we're in a woman's key, so it's much easier.
It's me, it needs a show.
formula, do you think, to your stuff?
Not really, no.
And I'm thinking because it has been covered by so many different kinds of people, males,
females. But maybe that's why, because we don't shoot for one formula, or we don't shoot for one kind of music or one kind of song. We grew up, as we were saying earlier, in three different cultures. So we've been nurtured and bombarded with all kinds of music our entire lives. It wasn't just English music or American music, it was all kinds, you know. Asian music, so that's been in our lives since we're children, you know. Traveling, being in a pyramid, being in India, being an immigrant family, you know, I think has done enormous amounts for us as children, because later on you use all that in your songs, you use all that in your information. We've seen things that kids never get to see at that age, you know.
No more will you cry, baby, I will let you never be started.
Said that it's almost to the point where your mouth goes dry talking about it now.
True.
You are aware, though, that a lot of people hold that record in very high regard.
Yes, so do we. So do we. I think maybe we've just been asked the same question over and over and over again, so it's like a bit like a record for us. Not so much, not so much tell us about Fever, but tell us about what happened after Fever. That's where we get. You know, we don't want to talk about that. It's like, you know, we were slapped around for having had a very successful album, and we didn't like it. And it made us very unhappy for quite a long time. We've outgrown that now. And now we're like everybody else. We sort of look upon Fever with some sort of reverence, like, you know, actually, it was quite a wonderful time. Why do we feel uncomfortable with it? So we don't feel uncomfortable anymore, you know? I think the media got the illusion that Saturday Night Fever, that we were a disco group because of Saturday Night Fever, and it's really an apparition. It's an illusion. It's not. We're a group that had many, many platinum records before Saturday Night Fever.
What we did, we're very proud of. To us, the music of the 70s, the late 70s, was never disco. We weren't a disco band. We'd had three platinum albums before Fever came along. We were quite happy doing what we were doing. And the music for the film was our new album.
We're going to go on and endeavor to make more. We're not really going to concentrate on being something that the industry seems to think we are, and it's not true.
But where the Bee Gees are concerned, they have very little to do with the movie and the whole process and the whole package of Saturday Night Fever. The only thing we had to do was three songs, and one of those was a ballad. And we had nothing to do with what they called the disco explosion. That was purely radio.
Midnight, jive talking,
We didn't even know what the film was about. We used to take the music, go on with the film. And we didn't see it again much later until they showed us some rough cuts.
We had no idea it was a film about a disco. In fact, disco was never even mentioned until after the album was released. But it became a dance phenomenon.
To be criticised for having had success is a difficult thing. Is a difficult thing.
Look, I don't know. I think people forget that we're also human beings. You know, we also have feelings too. You know, sometimes. No, but you do have feelings. I mean, we don't read reviews. We don't read press articles and things like that anymore. We used to get very upset when we were kids if somebody said something wrong about us or bad about us. But you know, it's negativity starts coming in all the time. You know, you're going to be miserable. You know, and it's not what we want to be.
We often come under fire for having done a disco album, or what people termed as a disco album in that period. I still object to, I always have objected to it, because to us it wasn't really a disco album, we were just doing another album. And that How Deep Is Your Love to me could never be termed as a disco song to me. It just never could be. So I'm proud of that music. Even today I still think it's good solid music, for us anyway. And and should never be put down by the disco haters.
Disco to us was like Casey and the Sunshine Band and stuff like that, and we were more into this in-house New York R&B type music. You know, it was entirely different from disco. How Deep Is Your Love was certainly not disco.
And you come to me on a summer breeze, keep me warm in your love, then you softly leave, and it's me you need to show. How deep is your love?
I don't think, if you were a music critic, I don't think you'd be right in saying it was a disco song.
Mm.
It's a song.
It's just that it was connected with the disco image, you see, unfortunately.
It's easy, I think, for the world out there to slag you off and just say, oh, great, it's the Bee Gees again, you know?
Yeah.
Mm. And then, for your own headspaces, do you even pay attention to that? We're songwriters, we're singers, let's get on with what we do.
Yeah, well, I resent the idea of people out there slagging us off, and I don't want to do an interview that's going to be like this, thanks.
All right, fire on.
No, I don't. I'm sorry.
No, I don't understand that.
Here you go, then.
Yeah, I just don't want to.
No, no, I mean,
that's...
I went to all yesterday, I just sped up.
What
happened?
No, I just had a bad time at an interview yesterday, but just slagging us off. It's just something I'm sensitive to.
I mean, it's like...
No, I just don't,
yeah. Being slagged off, or do we like it? I mean, do you two get the same questions? Do Genesis get the same questions as that? You know, it's like, that's just silly. Yeah. We don't feel that we get slagged off.
I just feel
off.
That,
you
know...
if we are, you know. It's just, it's an unimportant question. Really is.
Since, in a lot of the years since Saturday Night Fever, we've taken a lot of crap. And I think a lot of unnecessary crap as well. You know, this is one of the most successful bands that music has produced, that has happened in the last 20 years. I think we deserve more respect than we've got, or that we've had.
We've tended to go through different periods. We went through the disco period along with everybody else. I mean, Paul McCartney made disco records, the Stones made disco records.
Rod Stewart, those
were me. There is a tendency for everybody to jump on the bandwagon and if the bandwagon's big enough, you know.
And if everybody had jibes about any clothes that we wore, everybody in those days was wearing the same clothes, including Genesis, Queen, and everybody else.
That's all.
There's been a resurgence of our music in clubs and rave clubs.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I'm always on the floor with the crazy grooves. Tell me, can it feel the mad skills coming with the fever?
People love dancing to it. You know, it's just something that I think is great memories of the 70s that they love, that they didn't live through, that people are trying to live through now.
Yeah.
It's come full circle again.
Yeah. Yeah.
It has come full circle.
Blitz.
It's like the World War II, really. Yeah, it's just amazing how, as I say, the culture loves all that sort of music now, because the younger people never experienced it. They just heard about it. Now they're going through it because they want to experience it. And the folks that do remember it like remembering it, so they're going back too. But we're moving forward.
Yeah.
And we always have been.
You know, we were slapped around for having had a very successful album, and we didn't like it, and it made us very unhappy for quite a long time. We've outgrown that now, and now we, like everybody else, we sort of look upon Fever with some sort of reverence, like, you know, actually it was quite a wonderful time. Why do we feel uncomfortable with it? So we don't feel uncomfortable anymore.
you know.
We're proud of it now.
I think the thing about Fever is now it's beyond us. I mean, you can go into any nightclub in the world, they'll play a modern dance track, and then you'll hear Staying Alive or You Should Be Dancing. Yeah. And they'll play something from Fever. And it's the same with all over the world in any nightclub you go in. So it's part of not just pop music culture, it's part of the modern culture too. You'll just hear it. And
so, you know, you can stand outside. You can stand outside any club, which I have done.
Which you have.
And not been able to get in and still be able to hear my music inside.
Right, yeah.
Also goes back to what we've always talked about, the first fame thing, where you take it for granted when you become successful for the first time as a young artist or whatever. Mm-hmm. And if you do take it for granted...
Well, you believe every compliment, whether it's true or not.
Yeah. And if it starts to go, and you don't survive that, the buzz of having all that approval and attention goes away, you want something to replace that. We've gone through that, we've survived it, we've had mountains and valleys, we've done all that sort of stuff. You know, so we don't take it for granted, absolutely not.
No.
And you'll find a lot of people that have been around as long as we have. Do not take it for granted.
You don't take any of it for granted. For us, it's like Alice in Wonderland. We can't believe we're doing it. We can't believe we're still doing what it is we dreamed we'd do, you know?
Ever since we were kids.
There's really no ego with us. We don't think about it in those terms. We're a hard-working band, and we come from being a children's band, a band of kids, you know? So we nobody put us together, you know? It was something we made up our own minds, what we were going to do with our lives, you know? And we're constantly shocked that things we do still work.
Walking around earlier, there were some pictures that my jaw was hanging. You know, there you are with Princess Di. There's Roy Orbison. There's a number of people who are no longer here with us. When something like that happens, do you ever look at sort of your own mortality or ever?
I think we look at it a lot more now, particularly since the losing Andy. But that brought us much closer together. And once again, it's the things you don't take for granted. You know, I mean, I wake up in the morning and I go, why me? You know, sometimes, because some of the things I used to do, I don't know why I'm here. But there's a lot of people out there that have made it through and survived it, and some people don't. And that's part of it, once again, is the fame thing. You know, if you don't survive it, you know, you could turn to something that could kill you. And if that doesn't, something will, if you don't keep on persisting with your talent and making it better and get sensible.
Or keep yourself together.
Yeah.
Taking care of yourself, because if you can't have longevity in this business if you don't take care of yourself. The average span is 5 years. You know?
I mean, I have friends too, like that aren't on the wall, like John Bonham from Zeppelin, and people like that, who was a good friend of mine, the drummer, and died at 32. You know, and this guy could drink me under the table, but 6 pints of beer. Jimi Hendrix, there's all these people that were so talented, you know, that we've seen in our lives and met and lost.
It's funny how the business of creativity attracts drugs, attracts these things, these stimulants, these. Tennessee Williams actually made the quote that he'd never written a book without being high. And it just shows you that most writers, most authors, take stimulants to write, you know. And when we were young, we thought we were the only ones, and the Beatles thought they were the only ones, you know. But you did that. You went through those scenarios. We wouldn't do it now.
You were invincible in those days. You know, when you're you're 17 to 25 or something, you think you can do anything.
You get legless, you know. But everyone else is legless, so it's okay. You know? Yeah. These days, it's not like that at all. What's important these days is that you really keep your head together. Yeah. But it's all drugs, you know? I mean, I had a... I wouldn't usually quote this, but I had a conversation with Frank Sinatra, okay? And he, at the time, he was about 65. And he was... I just stopped smoking, and he offered a cigarette to Linda, and then he lit up. It was about half an hour before he was going on stage, and it was like he smoked Camel, you know? And I said, oh, yeah, and he offered me one. I said, no. I said, no, I've stopped. He said, I can't stop. He said, I've smoked my whole life. He said, I'm 65. Why should I stop now? Mm-hmm. And I never understood that answer. I just thought, well, yeah, but you might live till you're 85, which he did. You know, but he didn't see the sense in not taking that drug. Yeah. You know, but you see that with people, and you can't fathom it.
Yeah.
You know? Because if it happened to me, I think it would be so frightening to me that I would never touch a cigarette. You know, that these things cause cancer.
Self-preservation, look after yourself, is not something that really has anything to do with age, but time and experience. That, you know, there's a lot more to enjoy in life. And
or is it? Do you look after yourself because of other people? You look after yourself for your family. You look after yourself as a parent. Because you have responsibilities you didn't have before. Maybe there's something to do with that. And you just, if you're going to do it, you do it less. And then you don't do it at all. You know?
Yeah, and I think if you're really going to stay the course in your life and do things that you want to do for a long time, you've got to stay off drugs. You can't
watch your dream. Because if you've got a dream, then that's your drug.
When you said you wanted to be the Beatles, looking back,
well, everybody did.
Yeah, but very few can look back and realize that you know, you could, you, this band can say that the Beatles were now your peers, they were your contemporaries. Boy. All this time
later. We always have trouble with that. Yeah. Because we love them so much. To us, they're on a pedestal. They're beyond any band, and
they're beyond even trying to be.
It's not that they were a band, they were more than a band. They were a culture shock, and I remember personally every single age group liked the Beatles. There were very few people that weren't into the Beatles. In fact, if you weren't into the Beatles, there was something wrong with you. And that's very different today.
When Robin, Barry, and Maurice get to the microphone, it is magic.
They'll always be there because they're songsmiths. Do you know what I mean? They create great songs.
One bar, and you know it's them.
Any song you've ever done, I know them all.
When I hear them, I definitely stop what I'm doing and I just listen, you know what I mean?
Those guys were such great songwriters.
The way you hold the Beatles in high regard, these people are holding the Bee Gees up in high regard.
Well, yeah, that's very nice, but you know, the truth is they probably hold the Beatles in the same regard we do, and the same people.
You really can't wrap your heads around the fact that people put you on a pedestal then?
No. No.
I can, I love it.
You love it. That's the answer I was looking for.
Yeah. I think it is hard because if you've been up and down and up and down, you tend not to take anything for granted.
If I was to ask you to give me the top five recording acts of all time, who do you think they'd be?
Grateful Dead, Rolling Stones,
Michael Jackson.
Elvis Presley, he sold a lot of records.
Yeah, Elvis has sold a lot of records.
Madonna.
U2. Pink Floyd.
Frank Sinatra.
Let's throw Led Zeppelin in there. They sold a lot of albums.
The Beatles,
yeah, sure, yeah, of course.
And would you be surprised if I told you the Bee Gees are in that top five?
No kidding. Yeah. I wouldn't have thought that.
The Bee Gees?
Yeah.
For real?
Bee Gees?
Yeah. I'd be surprised.
Why would that surprise you?
I don't know. They just don't strike me as being as popular as people like Grateful Dead or Rolling Stones or something like that.
And I'm wondering why that surprises some, do you think?
Because pop. Usually what happens is if anything's really popular, everybody wants to kick it. But what's kick... I mean, and when I say kick it, as far as kick it down,
right.
Don't like pop acts for some reason. A pop act is popular, so everybody likes it. And usually what happens in life, everybody that likes everybody, nobody else likes it. So it's a reason for them not to like it, because it's popular. Bee Gees are fantastic, put out a lot of albums. They write their own stuff. They write for other people. you have to practically put them up there with the Beatles, Stones, pop, not rock. So if you say rock, then you look in a different categories. As a whole popular, I put them right up there with everyone else.
It was sort of an enigma, because no one can really explain it. We've been through so many ups and downs that it's impossible to explain what we are or where we fit in. And maybe that's okay. It is for us, because we don't enjoy being grouped with anybody. We like the idea of being unique. We like the idea that we can still surprise people. That's all great for us. We don't need to feel that we're on a pedestal. And if we feel that we're on a pedestal, we won't do good work.
We gotta fall off a lot.
Keep the hunger going, you know? We fall off a lot. No closer to the fire.
We have you on tape in 89 saying it would be a dream come true for this band to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Yeah. We have many dreams. We have many ambitions and dreams for ourselves as a songwriting group. We'd love to get in the Hall of Fame.
Well, fast forward after stating that goal and it was achieved, what goals are there at this point?
Many.
Well, yeah.
Many. We'd like to write something that would be acclaimed as being the best thing we'd ever written. We still want to do that. We still feel that there's great work for us to do. You know,
there's a lot of energy, and
we're still excited about it. You know, we don't sit there going, oh God, what are we going to do next? You know, we just get on with it. Three, two, one.
The 1997 World Music Awards from glamorous Monte Carlo.
So actually, it's the fourth long lifetime achievement.
Yeah, there's the American Music Awards, the Brit Awards, this one, and we have the Hall of Fame coming up
in Cleveland.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, do you think that, you know, on one hand, it's great to be recognized, and it is an honor to be included in these things. But on the other hand, it's not over, and those things are usually reserved for people who.
Well,
like,
some of them.
And it's not like you guys got a brand new album coming out.
Yeah, but what else do you do it for? You know, I mean, I think you do it. Hoping that you're going to have longevity. You do it because you hope one day you're going to win a Lifetime Achievement Award. Why else do you do it? Songwriters Hall of Fame is the best. Songwriters Hall of Fame. That's the greatest thing that's ever happened to us.
Because that will be your legacy.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. That was the greatest honor for us.
But long after you're gone, those songs will still be here.
Well, that would be nice. That would be nice.
Because we're going to leave them. We're going to leave them here behind.
We thought we might take them with us. Maybe I have never had you. I've been lonely for you lately. I can't wait another day.
I'm walking around, I'm seeing a lot of awards, I'm seeing plaques on the wall. If you can distill one accomplishment down, Sesame Street Fever.
Oh, well, what can you say about Sesame Street Fever?
that hasn't already been said.
Already. So it was a triumph deluxe.
Somehow I always end up alone. Always end up alone.
sure.
We're almost there.
The doctor says I will.
To Donald.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, we just keep on doing what we love to do.
Yeah.
You know, it's very hard not to do what you love to do.
We're not counting the years. Other people are going, wait a minute.
Yeah, that all
but
counts.
We're literally not counting, you know.
We just get on with it and just years roll by.
Put the kind of man to throw his hand into the ring and go down without following through. The day turns into night. Go down, following through. The day turns into night.
Going through some of the lyrics on the new record, you say things that a lot of guys wish they could say to girls. Say to their wives, say to their girlfriends. Does it ever cease to amaze you that those kind of lines will still come to you? In different ways of saying things?
Well,
like that?
Yeah, a little bit. To us, it's still a surprise that we can come up with a song that people think is a good song. That's always a surprise to us, because we always think we've sort of slipped under the radar. You know, we always think, well, we got away with another one, you know? They bought this one too, isn't that incredible? You know, we don't have the same kind of feeling about what we're doing that other people have, you know. We don't have that amazing, striving confidence, you know. Everything we write is written with hunger and ambition, you know, and hope that some people will actually feel as good about the song as we will. But we don't automatically think something's amazing, you know.
What we think of is what is good to say. I mean, some guys would say, yo, bitch, you know, and that's romantic, you know.
But I'll go anywhere. I'll go anywhere with you. Time has gone, but I'll go anywhere. Yes, I'll go anywhere with you. I always told myself I would regret this day, and I would fall apart and watch you walk away.
You want to say things, but you say it in your music instead of...
Yeah.
You want to say things to your wife, but you don't quite know how to say it, you know?
And you've got to be really chuffing romantic, you know what I mean?
Yeah, we don't walk around the house sounding like the bard himself.
Oh, my darling, for what I would give to you.
How about putting the kettle on?
Shut up, put the kettle on.
I'll be in my motor car.
At your feet, my sweet.
Yeah, we'll sweep the kitchen first.
What do you want for dinner?
How long are you going to be in that bathroom?
Not long, my dear.
Not long, my dear, my rose, my sweet.
This is just where I came in.
What are you trying to say with the title, This Is Where I Came In?
This is where we... it's all full cycle. That to us, music doesn't change that much. And people were writing about the same subjects 30, 40, 50 years ago in different ways. The rhythms and patterns haven't changed that much at all. There's more vitality. The more we go into the future, the more vital everything becomes, the more exciting things become. And I think the culture is responsible for that. Everything in the past is a little bit tamer than what we're going to do tomorrow. For everybody. That's how the culture thinks, you know? So for us, it's full cycle. It's another decade. We've often said to ourselves, boy, this is where we came in. Or these songs that this group is doing sound just like the songs we did 10 years ago.
You can hear the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s in all music today. And a lot of that music is influencing the music of today in terms of lyrics and melody and their structure. So, you know, you're going to hear all of that. So it hasn't really left us.
Time has gone, but I'll go anywhere. Yes, I'll go anywhere with you. This is the danger zone. This is where I came in. They don't know what they do.
The first single, it was a big hit right out of the box in various countries around the world. And it's doing quite well, and it's doing well in Canada too.
Yeah.
You don't take that for granted anymore.
No, you never get used to that. And you don't take it for granted, definitely.
In fact, most of the time you expect something not to work. We've always worked from the defense. We've never been on the attack. We always respond to what's going on. We don't necessarily create what's going on, but we respond to it. And so in that, you don't expect huge success. If it happens, it's wonderful. But if you expect it, it can be highly, it can destroy you, you know?
Is that something you've always dealt with, or you...
No, it's just...
No, I can't deal with it at all.
Well, it will destroy you. In a certain way, it'll destroy the way you think. It'll destroy a lot of things. This is just where I came in.
Yes, I'll go anywhere with you. This is the danger zone. This is where I came in.
We've sold a lot of records. I think the last figure I heard was 110 million. A lot of people hearing that would say, I'd want to sit on the beach for the rest of my life and not do anything. But yet this band still chooses to go into a recording studio, work hard. Mm-hmm. No resting on laurels.
No.
Well, I think it's basically because we're artists first, songwriters and artists. And that's in our blood, you know, a painter paints all his life and doesn't stop. And, you know, nobody went up to Picasso. Although
what the bloody hell are you doing with that picture?
Picasso, he said.
No!
Put down that brush. No, but Picasso, he said, you know, this is what I do. You know, you've done 100 million paintings, Picasso. What do you want to do?
What do you want to do anymore?
100 million paintings, my boy. Why don't you take a holiday?
But it's true, and actors, you know. Michael Caine, Richard Dreyfuss, or anyone else, you know, Connery. You wouldn't go up and say, well, look, Sean, you've made X amount of films, you've done this, you've had your Oscar, you know. Take it easy. Go back to Marbella. Sit down and relax in the sun. Actors, musicians, you know, can be all the same too.
But what's the short answer? 100 million copies and we never got paid.
That's
the short answer. So we go back in the studio mainly for that.
Yeah.